Hi there, Sardar Yegulalp here for InfoWorld at IDG. Today in Smart Python, we're looking at the ways lists in Python can be sorted. There's two ways you can sort lists in Python. One, by generating a new sorted list from the old one. And two, by sorting an existing list in place. Let's look at each of these in turn because they both have drastically different behaviors. Python has a built-in function called sorted that lets us take a list and generate a new sorted list from it. It also works with other object types, but for now we'll concentrate on lists. So consider a list of randomly generated numbers using this script. If we pass the list to sorted, we get back another list of the same numbers, this time in ascending order. We can also sort in descending order by just passing the reverse argument to sorted. Now for numbers and strings, Python assumes a common sense default sorting order. They sort pretty much as you expect, alphabetically and in rising numerical order. But if you want a custom sort order, or you're dealing with objects that don't seem inherently sortable, you need to deal with that a little differently. With sorted, you can provide an argument named key. Key indicates a function that each sortable item gets passed to. That function will yield up a value that sorted can then use in turn to determine the sort order for the item. Now in this example, we're using a function that determines if the item in question is greater than 5. That will yield a Boolean value, greater than 5, less than 5. And since Booleans sort in the order of false to true, that means that all the numbers in the list less than 5 get sorted to the front. All the numbers greater than or equal to 5 get sorted to the back. Notice that there's no other sorting within those two groups. It's just being sorted by whether they're less than or greater than or equal to 5. The other way that you can sort lists is in place. This means that you're not generating a new list, you're just taking the existing list and sorting the items directly inside it. To sort in place, you use the sort method, which is available to all list objects. So all we have to do to sort a list in place is take our list and invoke sort on it. Sort will also take the key and reverse options, just like sorted did, and will yield the same results. Now bear in mind, sorting in place has a major behavioral difference compared to creating a new sorted list. The biggest is that it is a destructive action. You are operating on the original list, so its original ordering will be gone forever. Remember this if you want to work with the original data at some point. You may be better off making a copy by way of sorted if you want to keep the original data. Another corollary rule of this is performance. If you have a very large list with thousands of items, it can be much more efficient to sort it in place using sort than to sort it by way of a new list using sorted. This way you're not going through the overhead of creating a new list, and that can really add up if you're doing that many times over in a tight loop. One final note about sorting is that whichever method you choose, the sorting method will only need to pass over the list once. The downside of that is, again, if you have a longer list, it will take longer to sort, but at least it won't need to traverse the list more than once to do it. Again, the main reasons to keep this in mind are performance. If you have a very large list that needs sorting, you'll probably want to sort it in place, and you'll probably want to keep the amount of sorting action to a minimum. Finally, when you sort a list, you can't use default sorting on a list that has a mixture of items. A list of both strings and integers, for instance, can't be sorted. You'll get a type error if you try to do that. But you can use the key function as a way to get around this problem. In this example, I have the key function use the integer value of each element in the list as its sort key. It converts each element to an integer, assuming it can be converted. Note that this does not change the elements in the list into integers. It just uses their integer values, assuming they can be converted at all. That's why I have this try except block, which catches anything that can't be converted into an integer and just renders it as zero, such as the none value. That's it for this episode. If you like this video, leave a comment below. And don't forget to subscribe to our IDG Tech Talk channel on YouTube. And for more Smart Python, be sure to follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.